Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. Well, thank you all for coming. I like stories. I like Zen stories in particular. One of my very favorite Zen stories is about a farmer. I grew up in Iowa, which is in the center of America, so I know about farmers. And this was an old man in China. And one day, his horse ran away. And all the villagers came to tell him, "Wow, what bad luck. What bad luck that your horse ran away." And I will tell you, living in a small town, growing up in a small town, that's what they do. People in your town want to tell you about your bad luck. Well, the next day, the horse comes back, and it brings two more wild horses with it. And all the villagers rush over, and they say, "Oh, you're so lucky, you're so lucky, you've got two more horses." And the farmer says, "Maybe, maybe." The next day, his son thinks, "I'm going to tame one of these horses, okay?" So the son goes and tries to break the horse, and the horse throws him down, and he breaks his hip, and he breaks his ribs, and he breaks his shoulder. And the villagers all come, and they say, "Bad luck, what bad luck." And the old farmer says, "Maybe." Well, the next day, the army comes through, and the army's taking all the young men off to the war where so many young men have died. But he's broken, right? The army does not want him. And the villagers say, "What good luck?" And the farmer says, "Maybe." This is my career, to be quite honest. When I went to LinkedIn, everybody said, "Why are you going to a resume site? That's so boring. Resumes? You can't do anything with a resume site." When I went to Zynga, they said, "Congratulations! You're working at the hottest company in the valley." You know, nobody knows anything. You can't predict whether or not it's going to work out in the end. However, you can say maybe, and you can try to make things work. So I've made a lot of amazing things happen. And I've learned so many things I want to share with you. One thing is, don't get sued. And by that, I mean, I'm going to tell you a little story, and I swear this is not about anybody I know. But once upon a time, there was a startup. A little startup in the Silicon Valley. And this startup had a vision, and the vision was they were going to bring tea. Good tea to restaurants. Now, I don't know about Argentina. I understand there's an awful lot of coffee in Brazil. But in the Silicon Valley, you can get lovely coffee, but the tea is not nice, not nice to drink. So one of the entrepreneurs was Chinese-American. Her name was Hannah. She went to Stanford, and she had studied, she was studying to be an MBA. And since she was Chinese, she wanted good tea. The other entrepreneur, his name was Jack. He was British, and he was very annoyed that people in the Silicon Valley thought that Earl Grey was a person and not a tea. He's like, "I will teach you about tea." And together, they went out to bring great tea from small farmers to restaurants. And because they went to Stanford, and they could do a little math, they actually were able to raise just enough money to get going. And they got an office, and they hired people, and they made a beautiful website, and they were so excited. They're like, "We got funding, we must be succeeding, right?" Well, this kind of business is called a marketplace. And for a marketplace to work, you need people selling tea and people buying the tea. There were lots of tea growers who wanted to sell their delicious tea, but they weren't finding very many restaurants who were willing to order the tea. And this was an uneven market, and it was dangerous. So Hannah had an idea. "I wonder if instead of selling to restaurants, I can sell to restaurant suppliers." And restaurant suppliers are these guys with these, sorry, I'm missing a slide. The restaurant suppliers are the guys with the big trucks, and they bring big cans of tomato sauce and 20,000 pounds of flour and half a cow to the restaurants. They bring vast quantities of stuff to the restaurants. And she thought, "I can sell to these guys." And it worked. She was able to start selling to the restaurant suppliers. She suggested it to Jack, and Jack said, no, these guys are the guys who are the reason tea is bad in the first place. We don't want to sell to restaurant suppliers. They're horrible people. They sell things in bulk. They don't care about art. They don't care about design. They don't care about quality. And they fought for a while, and then they decided they would talk to Jim. Now, Jim was their angel, and an angel is the first person to give you money. And he was wise, and he'd invested in Google and LinkedIn and all those successful companies, and they trusted him. And they went to Jim and they said, what do you think we should do? And Jim said, I'm going to tell you a story. I used to work at Intel. Now, Intel, you may think of as a chip manufacturer, but they used to be in memories. In fact, Gordon Moore, one of the founders, is the reason we have Moore's Law, that we have twice as much memory every year. So they made lots of money on memories. But then something happened. The Japanese started making memories, and they were just as good, and they were much cheaper. And basically, the Japanese were eating their lunch. They were taking all their business away. So Andy said, I looked out the window at the amusement park, and I thought, if we got kicked off right now, you and me, Gordon, and the board brought in a new CEO, what would we do? What would that new CEO do? And Gordon Moore said, oh, that's easy. He'd get us out of memories. He would get rid of the thing that made us who we are. And Andy said, let's pretend that we're that new CEO, and let's pretend we don't care about our history. Let's pretend that we can take this opportunity bravely. And you know, these are some happy old white guys. It worked out for them pretty well. So this is the story of Intel. Intel is very successful now. So Jim told our little guys, let's pretend we've already decided. What would that look like? And Hannah and Jack said, well, maybe we'd hire a sales guy, and we could change the website, we could hire a sales team. And they realized it wasn't that much work, you know? They had to make some changes, but they could live with it. And the important thing is their vision, their mission of getting tea to the restaurants would still happen. So they said, yay, restaurant suppliers, now we're going to be rich. But wait, there's more. Jim pointed out that they were about to change the vision of the company. And some people were going to be uncomfortable with this change. And he said, in order to make sure that everybody focuses on the same thing, I'm going to suggest you try something. I want you to try OKRs, objectives and key results. And you're thinking probably what Hannah and Jack thought, which is, what? Yet another Silicon Valley jargony acronym? But this one's a pretty good. It started in Intel also. And it started as management by objective. And all that means is, instead of telling people what to do, instead of saying, you build this, and I'm going to come by every 5 minutes to make sure you're actually doing it, what if instead we just told people what we wanted the end result to be and trust that they were smart? Trust that they were smart enough to figure this out. So the objective is the dream, the thing you want to see happen. The KR is the success criteria. How do we know we've arrived at our dream? How could we measure that? And you know, John Doerr from Intel, who brought it to Google, brought the OKRs to Google. Google didn't just adopt it, they embraced it. Google, everybody at Google has an OKR to this day. They started using it when they were 20 people, and they're still using it despite the fact that they're a small city right now. OKRs are part of their culture because they hire really smart people, say, go over there, self-driving cars, social networks, and they just trust people to make it happen. So the objective is qualitative. It's a shoot for the moon dream. It should be inspirational. A good objective makes you leap out of bed in the morning and go, I'm gonna go change the world today. So Hannah thinks, establish epic value to restaurant suppliers to be the best tea provider. The KR is quantitative. How do we know we met the objective? Jack thinks, hire a sales guy, redo the website, place ads in the No. Those are tasks. We can't help it. As soon as we start thinking about our dream, we start making a checklist. But that's not a result. That's just something to do. So he thinks, how would I know we were providing epic value? What would that look like? Reorders at 85%. 20% of the reorders are self-serve. It means people are using a website. Maybe a revenue of $250K. Now, I know some of you designers are probably going, my God, These numbers are really boring. And some of you, if there's some product managers out there who are metrically oriented, are thinking, this objective is too squishy, silly, epic value, really? But that's the magic of OKRs, is they take the dream, and they take the metrics, and they take the entire company and hook them together and point them in the same direction. So Jim says, you want flexibility in the how, not the what. All that means is you want to tell people, go here. We don't want to tell them how to do it. We don't want to say, do this, do this, do this. That's just not scalable. So objective, build an effective sales team and build a responsive customer service approach. They get excited. They just keep adding objective after objective. They're like, okay, we're going to do all this awesome stuff this quarter, and we're going to become wealthy. Now, I'm going to take a pause for a second, and I'm going to do an exercise as well. My Spanish isn't good enough to have any idea what exercise you all did earlier, but I'm going to guess you were talking to each other, so you may have made friends. But please turn to the, take a second, get out your notebook, and think of an objective, either for your work or for your life. What's something amazing that you would love to see happen in this quarter? And then ask yourself the question, how would I know it happened? What are the signs the universe would give me? If I said, I wanted to be healthy, you could say jog 3 times a week, but that's a task. Or you could say, lose 20 pounds. That's a result. If you jog, you lose weight, or so I've been told. Okay, so we're just going to take a few minutes here. So just take a second and quickly write down an objective that's going through your head right now for your life or work, and try to come up with 1 to 3 KRs, okay? Just take 2 minutes. Remember, it should be something that gets you up in the morning. So exciting, so amazing if it happened. Something that will take you about 3 months to accomplish, about 1 quarter to accomplish. If you haven't got a KR, a key result, take a second now and write it. We're going to wrap up in 30 seconds. Okay, the second part is now you are going to turn to that neighbor, and hopefully your objective wasn't too personal, and share it. And I'd like you to critique each other's objectives. So, partner, look at that objective and say, is it aspirational or quantitative? So a bad objective that I got recently from a CEO I was working with was, he said, we want to raise sales 30%. That wasn't qualitative. That wasn't aspirational. So make sure that your objective is a dream. And then the KR, make sure it's a result, not a task. So just take, we're going to take 2 minutes. Just share them and look at them. And if they're private, you can say, I don't feel like sharing right now. But please, please try out sharing with somebody sitting next to you. If you haven't swapped, swap partners. If you haven't shared your objective yet, change. We'll take one more minute. Okay, wrap up. Last words. Let's come back. You know, hopefully this is a chance to make a new best friend. Nothing like sharing your dreams with a complete stranger to kick off a conversation. I think it's really important to share them with somebody who can keep you honest. It's actually very tricky to form your first OKRs. So, you know, Hannah and Jack, to go back to our story, they bring their OKRs back to the team. They're super excited. They're like, we're gonna do this, it's gonna be great. The team's like, okay, well, yeah, you see, we got about 14 of these things to try to do this quarter, whatever. And 3 months goes by, and Hannah and Jack are so excited, like, We're going to have some great numbers, right? We set some amazing goals. Guess what? Let me introduce you to another new word from America. It's called whiffed, and it's when you swing the bat and it goes right by the ball. Or I guess in your case, you kick and you don't hit the ball. The team did not hit a single goal, not one goal. They whiffed them all. And you know, Hannah and Jack are like, I knew this was a fad. I knew this was a stupid idea. This is, let's call shenanigans on Jim. That's a way of saying this is nonsense. And they get a call. It's Jim. Jim says, hey, I know you've been looking for a new CTO. I want you to meet this guy. I think he's going to be really great for you. Meet Raphael. And they're like, oh, he's like a little too cool for us, this hipster CTO. But they see his t-shirt, and they're relieved. Okay, he's one of us. He's of the nerd people. And Raphael, like, looks at what they're doing. He hears their story about OKRs, and he says, you're doing it wrong. What do you mean you were doing it wrong? Well, I used to work for a big gaming company that used OKRs. And let me explain to you how you can make these OKRs actually work. You need focus. Focus is the answer. You need one objective, not five objectives. One dream that you're going to focus on for an entire quarter to get it done. It unites all the efforts throughout the company. You only want three key results. You don't want 16 key results. You have to be able to remember these. You have to wake up every day and go, this is the thing we're doing. It'll define your success. OKRs are not everything you're doing. It's not a laundry list of everything you're going to do over the quarter. It's the one thing that you have to do if you do not wish to die. It's the one thing you have to do if you want to be awesome and successful. You've got to focus. And I will tell you, this is the hardest thing for every company to do. I've talked to so many CEOs over the last 2 years, and they're like, can we just have two, three, five? No. If you have one, you will get it done. You also need a cadence. A cadence is a rhythm. I went to a tango show last night, so I know you guys all got rhythm in your blood. But it's just a rhythm of getting things done, steps you take over and over again. And that rhythm is Monday are for promises, Fridays are for winners. So this is a board I like to use to do the Monday check-in. And by the way, I see a lot of pictures. I put all my stuff on SlideShare, so you can download this. It's available as a PDF. There's even a blank template if you want it. So that is your commitment. Those are three absolutely vital things that you promise to your team you'll get done. Sounds a little like Agile, right? You're swearing to your team, these things I will do to make my OKRs. And why are there three? Once again, focus. Also, I don't want to be in a meeting with you telling me the 50 things you're going to do this week. That is a very boring meeting. So I just want to know the big ones, the ones that matter. The next 4 weeks are your heads up. Often in companies, product's about to launch something, and marketing hears like 2 days before, and they're angry. They're like, wait, I need to, like, you can't launch right now. I have to make brochures. Why anybody makes brochures is beyond me. But they get very upset when they're surprised. So you have an area that's about a heads up. Up here is the OKR confidence. We're going to talk about it. You thought you were going to make this key result, and all of a sudden you're doubting it. You're not sure. So let's talk about why that's happening. Let's see if we can come up with a solution to work as a team to make our goals. And the last one is organizational health. Now, when you're pushing really hard to do impossible things using OKRs, you can kind of mess up your other stuff. If you're trying hard to get new customers, are you remembering to take care of the old customers? When you're trying to get the new product out, are you burning your team out? Are you making them work weekends? Are you writing bad code? So the organizational health is to make sure that while you're pushing on the OKRs, you're protecting on the organizational health. You pick a couple things that you just can't afford to get wrong. It's not that complicated. Protect what matters. You dedicate every week to your team and to your goals. Fridays are for wine and wins, or beer if you prefer, or cake, or whatever. I know a teetotaler company that likes to have soda pop and cake. I'm sure after these Fridays, they'll be 300 pounds each, but you know. On Friday, you get the entire company together around 4 o'clock. Please don't make them stay till 10 p.m. And you do an engineering demo. Everybody shows whatever code they've written. This sounds familiar. Most agile teams, I believe, do demos. But wait, why doesn't design demo? You know, we're making beautiful, usable, terrific things. Let's show whatever design did. Hey, what if sales and biz dev shares their wins as well? And you know, let's drink some beer together. Very often in a company, maybe in your company, we're sitting there going, there's that guy. He wears suits. I don't know what he does. You know, if you all get together on Friday and talk about your wins, you get really inspired and you get to know each other and you get to figure out what everybody in the company is doing for the company. And if somebody's never doing anything for the company, that comes up too. Everybody needs bragging time. Everybody. Motivates the team to have something to share. Makes you feel like you're part of something special. Shows progress. You feel like you're part of a winning team. Even though the OKRs might be pushing you and you're not sure you're going to make your goals, you're still winning every week. So we went back to the team, and they're so sad. They're like, we whiffed everything. The CEO's mad at us. We're a mess. And Hannah's like, you didn't make your OKRs, guys. Million excuses, you know. I don't think we're marketing right. We had some problems with the performance of the site. We had to deal with late orders, blah, 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 blah. It's like, no. The thing is, when you're trying to do something really hard, if you're really sending an OKR that's a huge stretch goal, it's okay if you don't make it. The important thing is to focus hard. So these guys, Jack says, we're going to only have one OKR this quarter. That's it. We're going to do our weekly check-ins, and we're going to have our Friday celebrations. 3 months go by, and because this is a fairy tale, they made 2 of the 3 KRs. Now, that may not sound like a total win, but if these are genuinely hard, shoot-for-the-moon goals, 2 out of 3 is good. It's pretty sweet. And you know what? Their metrics are growing. The numbers are going up. Mysterious numbers going somewhere. They get their Series A. Woo! We have enough money. We don't have to fire everybody and move out of our cute office. Yay. Do they live happily ever after? Maybe. But you know what's important about this is they will not fail because they got in their own way. Nothing is sadder than failing because you couldn't get out of your own damn way, because every shiny object came by that you couldn't say no to. OKRs create the kind of focus that lets you have a chance. But wait, there's more, to take a line from Jim. So I left Zynga about 2 years ago, and I will tell you, every night I would take Prilosec, which is an anti-acid medicine, and I would wake up every 2 hours and I would take Tums. My stomach was destroyed. I had an ulcer. I wasn't seeing my daughter. It was killing me. And I left. I left the corporate world completely, because I didn't want to destroy my life. And I said, well, now how am I going to get my life sorted out? And I thought, I have a system. Let's see if it works. So I set an objective. Can I be financially stable and preserve my health doing the work that I like? I set a KR, earned 30K over 3 months doing work I do even if I wasn't paid. It's not a huge amount of money, but it's respectable money. If you saw the rents in where I live, you would understand why that's not a huge amount of money. But I set myself a KR. I set myself another one. Have manageable budget to predict expenses. To be quite honest, I was making good money. I didn't know what my budget was. I'd buy clothes whenever my boss yelled at me. I needed to sort that out. So I was like, let's get a budget. And then I had to ask myself, if I was healthy, what would that look like? What would a result be? Not a task, not jog. And I thought, 0 acid reflux, 0 back pain. Those were my stress indicators. I'm sure you guys are all sitting here going, yeah, when my boss hates me, my neck hurts, or my back hurts, or my stomach tightens up. You know, your body will tell you what's going on with you. So you can set a KR of health. And then, because I didn't have, you know, a team to check in with, I went ahead and I set my coach a weekly status. And I would set my OKRs right here, and whether they were going down or if they were going up, you know, what was going on. And then I'd say what I did last week and what I did next week, you know. And it was a way of just constantly checking in. And something really interesting happened. I started learning all the ways I got in my own way. Just like companies will learn what makes them slow down, I learned what slows me down, and it was amazing. So now I live my happy dream life. My daughter as a pirate, me as a fairy princess, all because of OKRs. I really think that it's an amazing, amazing tool to find a way to actually make the goals that you're trying to achieve. So thank you, and we're going to have a nice long Q&A session.